Like, if the guy has just played the best, sure, we should just, yeah, he's the favorite to win the tournament because he's been playing great. But yeah, that deck right there, Lorinda, it's almost as if you have a direct feed to our Japanese production. That deck right there, that is not a Reno lock. That is two Twilight Drakes, two Doomsayers, two Mountain Giants, two Hellfires, two Faceless Shamblers. That is a good old-fashioned Handlock deck. And I say good old-fashioned Handlock deck. It's a very, very different deck from when Heelbot and Sludge Belcher and Molten Giant were playable cards in Standard. I almost said in the game then, but just adjusted to playable cards in Standard, because that does, in fact, cover Molten Giant, which is no longer a playable card in Standard.
So, something with this deck that, if you played this deck a lot, and or so if somebody like high-powered, well-known, played a lot of Handlock, they would start getting destroyed because it has significantly obvious weaknesses that yes. would be found out. However, bringing it to a one-off tournament, maybe you can get away with it?
It's interesting because, you know, we were casting Oya yesterday, and I made the point that, you know, I've played thousands of games of traditional Handlock, of Molten Giant Handlock. Thousands and thousands of games. And I tried out this deck, or a version of this deck that Shitan Adachi posted and said he was being successful with it. And I just couldn't get on board with it at all. So watching Uya play it yesterday, he definitely played it a lot more tempo focused. You know, the deck does have the capability of doing that by, you know, just doomsaying on two, imp gang bossing on three, playing, you know, Twilight Drake or Refreshment Vendor on turn four and going from there. Yeah, he was committing his 2/3s to the board, his Sunfury Protectors as just individual minions, which is definitely something that you did anyway in old Handlock against aggressive matchups. So it's definitely not the tap, pass until turn four deck that it used to be. It kind of power spikes a little bit later than old-fashioned Handlock used to do, but it has some serious, serious weaknesses, as you said, which is primarily just the lack of huge burst healing, you know. Alexstrasza and Jiraxxus can often come too late. It's the Heelbot that's the really big miss here. That huge burst of healing for 8 in one card is such a big deal, such a big miss. You're trying to make up for it in this deck with cards like Refreshment Vendor and Earthen Ring Farseer, and they just don't quite get you there in the long run.
Right, but that I was alluding to that like in the opening comment there. If your opponent knows what to do about it, and who knows what? Who's played any games against Handlock in the last 3 months? So it's, you know, the weakness is just keep the damage coming any way you can. Don't be scared to Fireball Face. Just ignore the board to some degree. I mean, some of these minions you can't ignore.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely the plan. Just hurt your opponent, make them experience pain, and force them to have the healing. And if you're looking for a deck to be able to do this, Gundam Flame's Aggro Shaman and Gundam Flame as a player is perfectly equipped to be able to do that, because Gundam Flame in his first series showed a grasp of when to be aggressive, which was far and beyond anything we've seen from any other player. Yeah. We saw in Oya's matchup that he won, the game that he eventually won with his Handlock, I think there was a missed opportunity from his opponent to just forgotten torch him in the face at one point in the game that he just completely missed and changed the texture of the game entirely.
Whoa, like, bangs.
Gundam Flame is going to miss those opportunities. But Gundam Flame, if that was correct, his Aggro Shaman was banned.
Yeah, both Shamans banned, I believe, from that graphic, which is the best graphic we've seen in 2 days. I'm going to roll with that for sure. His Mage is interesting, by the way. It only has one card, Yogg, which costs more than 5 mana in the whole deck.
Gundam Flames.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I made this point when we cast him yesterday. This is the Tempo Mage list that I like. It's just curve out to 5, kill your opponent. If that goes wrong, then you have the backup of Yogg. This is the list that I like to play. I don't like messing around with Cabalist Tomes and stuff like that. I think if you do want to go into that later game stuff, then you need to add the later game win conditions that we saw yep. from Napika in the previous series. But I think a lot of people are just kind of adding these clunky cards to the deck with the Cabalist Tomes, etc., and not really adding in the late game win conditions to support them. So personally, again, just echoing back to Gundam Flame's aggressive strategy, he recognizes that Hearthstone is a game about killing your opponent, and that is what his decks are built to do.
I love how you word that. Just, it's a game of killing your opponent, you know, like it wouldn't be. But yeah, it's sometimes you can overthink things a bit, and Gundam Flame, for all of his deep thinking, just, yeah, killing people is fun. quickly before I get arrested, move on.
Edge away, sounding terrifying right now. I'm not sure I'm comfortable on this cast anymore with you, Lorinda.
No one's ever comfortable with me on the cast, don't worry.
Okay, fair enough. So yeah, Gun and Flames opening hand looking a little bit slow. As we said, this is a very aggressive deck, so he's going to want a very aggressive start. But Uya picks up the Innovate, has the Maya Keeper to go with it, so he's got a nice hand to be able to fight back against this. Gun and Flame whiffs a little bit. Mirror Image, Flame Waker, not the opening he's going to be looking for. Yogg-Saron back in the opening hand. And this is not great.
When you bring a deck that you've curved low to be aggressive and you draw like this, having just watched the other guys going turn one Squire into Abusive Sergeant plus Grandmother with one of each in your deck, you feel kind of sad.
Yeah, almost unavoidable, really. But Uya now picking up the Emperor. Now the texture of his hand requires a little bit more attention than it would before. He could go turn one Maya Keeper, but turn two Maya Keeper will get him to four mana and preserve his coin, which then means that he can coin out Emperor a turn quicker than he would be able to otherwise. That Emperor essentially just functions as another ramp effect in this deck, basically. So you have to consider it in the same way that you consider your Wild Growths and your Innovates in terms of how to ration them out to make your curve the smoothest and the most consistent.
Yeah, I was wondering if he's going to drop this Blood Mage here. And the reason I was wondering is because he wants to keep it back for the damage. That's why it's in this deck. It's a very aggressive deck. But his hand is terrible.
Ooh, that Wild Growth was absolutely perfect from Uya there. Now he has the option of just keeping the Innovate even. He can go Maya Keeper to ramp to 6. Emperor to discount his Malagos and then just innovate out the Malagos and jam it on the board the next turn if he wants to.
And how does a deck with nothing that costs more than 5, with no polymorphs in it, I believe, deal with Malagos on turn 6 or 7?
Yeah, I mean, hard to say. He is going to go with the Emperor here. So he's going to discount his Malagos to 8. This means that next turn he will play Maya Keeper on 5 to ramp him up to 7 on his next turn. And then he can coin out Malagos. So yes, this is actually a better way of doing it.
Malagos with a 0 casting cost Living Roots in hand, which basically kills anything in Gundam Flame's deck.
Yes.
That's pretty terrifying.
Yes, I'm sure we will see Keeper to ramp here and has the Wrath to go with it to take care of the... keeps getting better, but yeah, Wrath to immediately take care of the Mana Worm. And that means 7 mana now on the next turn for Uya, plus a coin means Malagos is hitting the board going into the Mage's turn 6.
Right, so Malagos is going to take down 2 or 3 cards and do... Have the option to do something like 13 damage with naught drops as well. And in that time, Oya's going to have to draw any druid cards to just fill things out a little bit afterwards.
Yeah, Malagos is going to end the game as long as it can do it before turn 10. Because, honestly, the only real way that Gundam Flame can come out of this favorably is through a Yogg-Saron outcome. Because right now, he doesn't even have just a pile of burn that he can throw at Malagos over 2 turns. Like, he just doesn't have the damage in his hand to be able to kill this.
Right, and this is where Hearthstone is an unusual card game. One player has 8 cards, the other has 4. And the guy with 4 is incredibly close to winning this game.
Yeah.
And it doesn't even look, like, at a glance, that terrifying. Like, kill the Malagos, he has no cards left. It's over. But you just, the Malagos is going to eat so many cards just by being on the table that card advantage is not the thing it is in other games.
Yeah, I think this is his only hope. He just has to fireball it and try and pick up some more damage on the following turn to deal with it, or try and get lucky with the Flame Waker and Arcane Missiles. But that, I think, was an Ancient of War. Yes, it is. That is the dream pickup from Uya here. And now I think you back this up just by firing the Living Roots straight at the face here and just try and get this game over with as quickly as possible, because you cannot let Gundam Flame's hand turn back into an advantage for him here, right? You need to end this game quickly before Gundam Flame can get value out of all those cards in his hand.
Right, because for all of your advantage on the board I was just talking about, 27 health has to be dealt with. Yeah. And he's just indicated he has another fireball in hand. He doesn't. He's playing to his outs. But you've got to be thinking that he has the chance to kill it in his hand.
Yeah, I think I would love to see the Living Roots come down here personally. Yeah, I love this decision. Bang, straight to face. That is a 0 mana spell damage fireball to the dome. absolutely ridiculous, threatening lethal essentially now just with the existing board presence, and Gundam Flame just cannot believe how oppressive this opening has been, but picks up the Apprentice, which means he has a serious Flame Waker turn this turn.
Yeah, absolutely crazy, and it's getting better. And interesting, he's going to shoot more missiles off here this way. Okay, now you just kill it off.
Perfect, with the blast, still has another missile, still has a mirror image. Oya is cringing here. He can't believe what's happening to his board here.
Everybody loves Flame Waker, right?
And now the mirror images neutralize the Ancient of War. This game has flipped on its head just purely on that Sorcerer's Apprentice pickup, because he had a good turn. He had a good turn with the Flame Waker.
Yes.
The Sorcerer's Apprentice enabled him to fit Arcane Intellect in there as well, which then picked him up another zero mana Arcane Blast, and that made all the difference.
Right, and it breaks the rule of thumb I was going about having things on board, because Sorcerer's Apprentice lets you play all of your cards that you had as advantage at once, which kind of breaks the rules a little bit. You're not supposed to be able to do that.
Yeah.
And he found a way to do it, and with all the combos, that amounted to something like 14 damage. I'm not going to quote that as an exact number, but it was a heck of a lot of damage.
There's two rules. Casters should never do maths, but definitely don't guess maths. That's just even worse.
It's okay to admit that you guess maths, right?
I guess that's true, yeah.
There you go. You're guessing now. Okay.
Now, suddenly, the board status has completely flipped, and Gundam Flame has to try and decide how he wants to deal with this. He can try and push through the Ancient of War here, and then take a value trade into the Blood Mage.
Considering pinging first on the Ancient as well, but he's going to just freeze this up and do it the safe way.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, I'm okay with this. He could have just been aggressive with the Frostbolt and chose to try and isolate the Arcane Giant against the one remaining Mirror Image Taunt, but he just chose to lock out that option entirely. And that swipe is a big deal for Oya right now, because that Flame Waker was basically carrying the game in the same way that his Malagos was for a couple of turns.
And both players feeling this. Gundam Flame seems to be enjoying the challenge as well. He's like living every moment in a good way.
He plays Cabalist Tome in his list?
Yeah, he plays one of. It's the top of the curve apart from Yogg.
Interesting.
It's just a refill. Because you're emptying your hand so quickly, it's a one of in his deck just to tidy up. He plays one book as well.
Yeah. So he's playing one Cabalist Tome at the top of his curve because he's going to have no cards in his hand.
Right, so turn 6, 7, 8, and 9, he might as well. Cabalist Tome on turn 6 is the plan.
Right, once he's run out of cards, yeah, he's just trying to rip some more burn out of the Cabalist Tome to finish the game. I mean, I guess I can. I'll give him a pass just because of how aggressive the rest of his deck is.
Right, it makes sense to have some refuel. And now he probably has to Yogg. Because if he takes 5 to the face immediately, then the Yogg becomes a lot more scary next turn.
It does, yeah. He had potentially 3 spells he could cast that turn. The Shatter's a little bit unlikely to be able to be cast that turn, I guess. But
the Ancient's dead, he's tested. That's why the smile came across his face. He pointed at the Ancient, and the Ancient wasn't there.
And that is... Oh, that's Astral Communion, though. That is not what he was looking for. Yogg take, Yogg giveth, Yogg giveth, Yogg taketh away.
This is just good news, bad news, every single spell. Heal for 6, and they just get rid of everything. And this excess mana is going to be really handy for him as well.
You have way too much spell synergy in your deck. There's literally zero reason to play it this turn. You might draw Flame Waker, you might draw Mana Worm, etc.
Did we see what the secret was in all that excitement?
Spellbender. It was Spellbender.
Okay. That's going to be a big deal as well at some point.
Yep.
Or not.
I mean, he just drew Swipe, which means it's probably going to be a big deal.
Yeah, I said or not because it looked like he's pointing at face for some unknown reason. I was like, what? Does he know it's Spellbender?
Cast to 0 this turn instead, and now that fireball being picked up means that Gundam Flame is potentially just straight up threatening lethal here. Just going to ping the face, push his damage to face, trust his deck to get him out of this, and the removal options for Oya just aren't there right now.
I guess he's wondering whether to fireball the 2/4, how much his 2/2s will get through if he defends them, but doesn't need to, it's lethal next turn.
So that Moonfire is a big deal for Oya. I mean, the reason why Swipe potentially wasn't cast in the previous turn is that he wanted something to cast to check for Counterspell and Spellbender, and now Moonfire is just about the best card he can have to be able to do that. He would have loved for the Moonfire to actually go off as well, because it does just improve his Swipe at the end of the day, but having it not activate here and be able to use the Swipe to be able to clear some of this pressure off the board is actually a really big deal in this situation.
Yeah, is it going to be there just in time? I guess.
Well, the Arcane Blast is going to take care of the 2-2, and Drake
what a pick
is
up.
The best draw in the deck that wasn't just directly lethal. So that is the second best draw.
Right,
in the deck.
Yeah, if you're not going to win the game, get cards that win you the game next turn and be on 16 health. Just seems legit to me. And that's going to be it, I think.
Yeah. Living Root's not going to be enough. Cannot take any significant amount of damage off the board. And Gundam Flame beating a turn 6 Maligos this game to come out victorious, which, you know, we've done our job in, you know, extolling the virtues of how well he's played this series. But I'm going to go on a limb here and say that a lot of credit for this particular victory, the first game here, has to be given to Flame Waker and Yogg-Saron.
And that pickup of the Sorcerer's Apprentice at just the right time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because he didn't have any...
He deserves it, right? If there's one thing in Hearthstone that you like to see, it's players that have played well getting rewarded.
Yes, for sure. And, I mean, he did do the right things with the bad hand. He kept the Flame Waker back in case he got the pickup to have the crazy turn, that sort of thing. There weren't really many times when he could have put it down, so it's not like it was some sort of genius play on that occasion. But when he got the chance, he took it. He knew how to take it. He did make some interesting decisions. He chose to freeze the Arcane Giant,
yep,
which bought him a bit more time as well. So he's thinking outside the box again, not just going through the motions, killing things that are obviously to be killed and so on. And he did play, when he froze that giant, he did play the Water Elemental, so he knew he had more freeze if other things came down.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt that he had that under control as much as the cards let him.
Yeah, that turn was particularly interesting to me because I think I would have Frostbolted the Ancient of War and tried to just isolate the giant against my 0-2 Torn and just preserved all my board pressure.
Yeah,
his play meant that he gave up the 3-2 Sorcerer's Apprentice, you know, all the time to trade through the Ancient of War. So I guess my play was a little bit greedier, which is interesting to me because generally Gundam Flame has been the greediest player in this tournament so far. He's been really, really pushing the boat out in terms of the risks that he's been taking. It was an interesting sort of divergent path in that matchup for him. But, I mean, if you end up winning a game where your opponent dropped Maligos on turn 6, you've probably made some good decisions as well as got a little bit of luck as well.
Yeah, and I think that's why we both like this player so much, because he hasn't got a pattern to his unique plays. His strong, different plays that other players may not have taken aren't just all, I go face more often than most people, or I do this. They're all different to each other, which means he's thinking very clearly about every aspect of the game.
Indeed, but if there is one pattern that develops, is that he does favour being aggressive. You can see that throughout his deck lineup. You can see that throughout his play, but that doesn't just mean slam face every turn. He's caught us off guard in both regards, by both holding back when we expected him to push, where it proved to be right, and by pushing when we expected him to hold back, where it proved to be right. So he's definitely evaluating the game on a high level here, but he's looking like the most aggressive player in this tournament for sure, but that is not an aggressive-looking hand for the Dragon Warrior now up against this Yogg-Druid.
And interesting that he chose to throw the Twilight Drake. That's always such a close decision. I mentioned it yesterday that it's like the keystone of all dragon decks. And if you're relying on dragon synergy, at least you get to play it on turn 4 if things go wrong. He chose to throw it away, and it's not worked out that great for him. It wouldn't be that great if he kept it either, to be fair, because now he'd be drawing one step further behind where he is at the moment.
And this is the nightmare, honestly. Armor up, pass on turn 2 for a Dragon Warrior. This is just absolutely miserable for him. He's going to be needing to pick up some action here, because otherwise he's just looking at dropping a 3-3 Ravaging Ghoul on the board as his first initiative play on turn 3.
Yeah, your Ravaging Ghoul is definitely... A 3-3 is not even an initiative card, right? Even as a worst case, if it's a monkey or something, at least get something down. But, yeah. Wow. just deciding to put down that, saving the Ravaging Ghoul for removal value or for damage value at least.
Yep.
And forcing Oya to take the 9.
And Oya, in stark contrast to some of the players that we've seen this tournament, chooses to take the 9. And it also has the added effect of saying, hey, if you have Ravaging Ghoul in your hand, because you've had a slightly awkward start, if Ravaging Ghoul is one of those cards in your hand that you haven't been able to curve out with, you can't play that card right now, buddy. Sorry.
Yeah, that may have been a slight oversight there from Gundam Flame. It wasn't a big one by any means, but he was trying to, with a bad start, being greedy with your removal, I think is fair enough, but it's really come back to bite him there. And Oya's hand. What is this hand?
It is a hand that contains a lot of mana and a lot of things.
Play Maligons if he wants.
Wait, oh yeah, 6-8-9 with the coin. That's insane. He could have actually just jammed Malagos on the board. That's ridiculous.
And it would have made his giant really cheap as well for the turn after.
I mean, you know, this is not the same kind of matchup as Tempo Mage, though. This is
exactly
not,
yeah.
Especially when your opponent has had a clunky start, which from your perspective is like, okay, so he had 4 cards in his opening Mulligan that were not.
How many executes? Not has
yeah,
he got
exactly.
It?
They weren't Alex Charles' champion. They weren't Fairy Dragon. They weren't Frothing Berserkers, Fierce Monkeys, Fiery War Axes. They were none of those cards. So what exactly were they?
And he's going to have to execute this, I think. I think he may be just considering eating 7.
He could just play a Ravaging Ghoul this turn and then choose to set that up on the board to contest. And if that doesn't work, then he can just Blackwing Corruptor it on the following turn.
I mean, he has kind of... Like, your armor's not particularly useful in this matchup. If you get behind, you stay behind towards, you know, from turn 7-8 onwards, I mean, not at the start. So there's definitely the option to just say, you know what, I'm going to eat this 7.
Did Oya, just looking at it, did Oya missequence the healing on the previous turn? I think he could have healed for more if he'd have hero-powered the Fairy Dragon first, right?
I'm just going to have to take your word for that one.
I'm pretty sure he could have invested in
this Ravaging Ghoul play.
I mean, there might be a divergent path in which case, you know, if he got, for example, a Sunwalker off the Moonglade portal, he would have just held on to the Innovate and ignored the Fairy Dragon and left it there. So I think for the sake of 1 damage, you can't really necessarily just call that a straight-up mistake, but it's something to look at least.
Right, and Gundam Flame's play is going to work out here. He's going to get to keep both executes and, you know, 28 or 35... It's not a giant difference in this matchup. If you get so far behind, you're going to lose anyway a lot of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's worked out nicely for you. He's finally managed to establish something on the board at the end of his turn.
He has, yeah. And he's going to decide not to just replay Skeleton Knight for the rest of the game. He is going to deal with this 5-4. He did win the joust, so he has Skeleton Knight back in his hand again now. But he's going to go for the removal line here. And that means that I believe Arcane Giant is going to hit the board. And now... the decision again, the greedy decision to not use an execute on that Skeleton Knight is going to start to be validated here from Gundam Flame, because now he gets to allocate one of those executes to an 8-8 minion, and he still has that spare execute for Malagos if it comes down to it.
And he's still looking to be even greedier if possible. Just making sure there's not an even better option.
I mean, he could play the Curator. That's a totally valid play this turn.
Yeah.
But that is an 8-8 on the board. There are some serious incentives to just clearing that thing off and moving on with your life.
And the board's just slowly getting better and better for him. Obviously, yeah. Oya's going to have some good turns in the future, but especially now.
Yes, he is.
Wow.
Yeah, that Emperor Thorasan makes some of his turns in the future look very, very promising indeed. But he is ceding this board initiative now to Gundam Flame. But is this Emperor, is the amount of board tension it represents, and the you know, it's a must kill?
No, go face play rag.
He trades.
Oh, no. No, I mean, whatever he does, I'm willing to say is probably correct. But I was excited to see him put 6 in the face there.
Yeah, if he put 6 in the face and Rag had gone face, then he would put his opponent down to 12 here with Emperor Thorasan still alive. Ragnaros is just a straight-up nightmare to deal with unless the Emperor has to trade back into it anyway, in which case the double discount never happens.
And if it hits the Emperor, then so be it.
Right, I'm definitely not averse to going face there, but you know, Gundam Flame, as we've said, has made the correct call on these really balanced decisions. Time after time so far in this tournament, so I'm willing to trust his instincts on this one.
Yep, so he's got an unchallenged 8-8 on the board as a result of what he did. with the curator in hand, maybe that was part of the decision process there.
Sure.
He could afford possibly to, in the way that you can ever afford to give away 2/3/3s and just draw some more cards next turn.
Agreed.
The pacing of the game is such right now that curator into the two dragons and then whatever you pick up from the curator after that seems okay. And this is where another thing about the curator is really good is it picks up Finley at the end of the game, not the start.
Yes, indeed. But that from Oya there, he was offered naturalize from that Raven Idol and he chose not to take it and instead just go with the really risky play of dropping the 1/1s on the board to just, you know, try and soak up some rag damage for him. And there is a 3-card curator, including, as you said, the Finley Murgleton, and I'm almost positive we will see a Blood to Ichor here being used.
Yep.
To try and take out one of these 1/1s.
No reason to be greedy here. You can play Finley as well, see where you stand first, which is what he's going to do.
Yep.
I'd probably still take Life Tap. It allows you to be not greedy. It allows you to just use these cards and spam them.
You've got to be careful here. Emperor was dropped. You just saw a Living Roots used.
Mm-hmm.
Generate on the board, but Emperor was dropped and there's a lot of cards in hand that just obviously weren't strong plays on that turn because it was just kind of a nourish pass kind of turn, plus the nourish itself has now pulled more cards into the hand, so you are going to have to be careful this game not to drop yourself into Malagos combo range with the Life Tap, but he does end up taking it and he does end up foregoing the Living Roots on one of the 1/1s.
Yeah, I'm not sure those two things are consistent. If you're going to take Life Tap, I think you do it because you want to blood the 1/1. Personally. I feel that if you want to play the greedy game and not die to the Malagos combo, fine. Don't be greedy with your blood, take something else. But I feel if you take the Life Tap, you might as well just not be greedy with the blood and give it away. Because you can, for two life you can just draw another card, obviously.
I mean, you know, on average, that Blood to Ichor does 4 damage to face, right? Like, half the time, it makes 8 mm-hmm. damage go to face instead of hitting a 1/1.
Yeah.
So, that's a pretty good Blood to Ichor.
And the last minion on the board has value. If you can kill the last minion on the board, it's so much better than leaving anything there at all.
Right.
So, you know, having a 1/1 is a lot better than having no minions, is what I'm trying to say, in a really convoluted, bad way.
But now it is going to be Malagos time, and here's a consideration for holding on to the Ichor. He doesn't have a clean execute activator mm-hmm. in his hand, apart from that Blood to Ichor, but he does have Finley on the board, and he also just could have chosen to take the Druid Hero power, which could have been his execute activator for him anyway. So, I don't know. I think it's a little bit suspicious not to to use the Ichor here, but it's going to represent value for him. Blood to Ichor execute plus 2/3/6 taunts this turn. Trade the 1/3 into the Living Root and
get the 8 guaranteed damage instead of the 4 damage that we gave him last turn.
Yeah, exactly. And this is a huge power play turn now. He's I guess just considering his options, he can generate one more power on the board by using Azure Drake and Fierce Monkey, more overall stats to just drop the two Twilight Guardians, but decision is more or less a wash either way here. It's just a devastating position either way. The additional consideration here is, do I overcommit into Yogg-Saron?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Something you pointed out at the time, by the way, Oya still has that Starfall in his hand doing nothing, and he's taking 8 a turn from this Ragnaros. I wonder if he's regretting that decision yet. I mean, Naturalize has a lot of downsides. You don't want to give Dragon Warrior 2 more cards, obviously. But that card's doing nothing at all.
I mean, he was staring at a Malagos hand, right? And was the first execute already used at the time that he made the...
Let's
Raven
go
decision?
With
I think,
yes.
I think it was, yes.
I'm not certain, but let's go
he
with yes.
He was looking at a Malagos hand in a game where one execute had already been used. So I can understand the mentality of my Malagos is going to stick to the board and then I'm going to Starfall literally any board that he plays and it's dead, right? I can totally get on board with that plan, but I just think the immediacy of that Ragnaros on the board when you didn't even have anything close to an answer. Dropping 2/1/1 Living Roots on the board is a pathetic attempt to try and mitigate that, right?
It is.
It's miserable. So I just think, like, I totally agree with you. Naturalize is not a good card. It's not a good answer to anything. sometimes bad answer is better than no answer.
Because this Ragnaros is just sitting there three turns later, happily destroying the druid. And it's just not going to end anytime soon.
No.
Well, it is. It's going to end in about two turns' time, but not for the reasons he wants.
So Gun and Flame, first things first, he's going to be looking for guaranteed lethal here. If he doesn't have guaranteed lethal, he's going to be looking for 50-50 lethal to set up either kill the last remaining minion or kill my opponent. He has Blackwing Corruptor to add 3 additional damage to something. The Azure Drake is making the Blood to Ica do 2, so looks like he can set it up here.
Oh, yeah, so you trade in the monkey, you trade in the 2/2s, and then you point face with your Corruptor. And then either your rag kills the 3/3 or it kills your opponent.
Well,
there's probably better ways of doing that.
Yeah, you point the Corruptor to do the last 3 damage on the taunt, and then you send your monkey face, because then you still have
then a monkey. Then you've got the same thing, yeah.
Yeah, and you still have a monkey.
And you still have a monkey.
Oh, okay. Oof. The lag is starting to reappear on the clients at the venue here.
Gets it.
And that would have been a really borderline admin call, right? Because that's not lethal on the board, but that is pretty much game over either way. So,
well, what Gundam Flame does there is he keeps his mouth shut and pretends he's passed the turn.
Right.
And doesn't complain about missing his go.
That's a fair point. But if he was not able to get that attack through on the last minion, that could have made a really big deal. So yeah, thank the heavens at least that he was able to get that attack through in the nick of time there. And he's continuing his dominance here, and he's looked like he was in a sticky spot in both of these games so far. The Dragon Warrior opening hand, remember that game? His first minion was a fairy dragon on turn 3, and he missed his 4-drop. He skipped turn 1, he hero powered turn 2, he played fairy dragon on turn 3. And
which looked awful the next
4.
Turn, yeah. Because he got hit and he got stuck with a ghoul in his hand.
Literally did not get onto the board until turn 5, and it was still enough to get him through.
So I know we've just sung his praises relentlessly now for half an hour, to the point that people are probably getting bored of it, but he clearly has terrific vision of how a game is going to pan out.
Like, I would agree with that assessment, yeah.
He could see that the whole fairy dragon line was probably the right line, despite the fact I said maybe it's an oversight, but he presumably had a feel for how that would pan out. And something you noticed yesterday as well, just to even more bore people by singing his praises, is that he seems to be able to make good reads on his opponent's hands.
Mm-hmm.
Like God reads in some cases.
Yeah, I mean, there was the turn in particular where he just ignored a Violet Teacher, where, you know, systematically, if you went back through the turns, you could start to realize that he'd ruled out Wrath, he'd ruled out Swipe, he'd ruled out Power of the Wild, so the Teacher just wasn't really going to hurt him that much. So yeah, he's looked like a really, really promising player here. So I'm sure if we say one more nice thing about him, I think we've reached critical mass of
yes.
A, where Twitch chat will start puking, and B, where we will have officially cursed him to the point where he will just lose the next 4 games straight and be out of this tournament.
Right, and never win another Hearthstone game.
Yes, in his also life. That.
Rank 25 forever. Oyo, on the other hand, doesn't seem to have done a whole lot wrong. He's made some slightly dubious decisions at times, but certainly seems to be at least relevant in this matchup. He's had some awkward decisions to make as well. Like, a lot of the decisions have looked bad afterwards to do with Innovate, but they've seemed okay at the time. Double Innovate decisions are hard.
Opening hand Malagos yet again from Oya. I mean, the previous games, it hasn't been the end of the world because he's had the ramp to go with it, but this time, all right, that Wild Growth changes a lot, at least. If he can start picking up more Wild Growths, Innovates, and or Nourishes from these Raven Idols, then maybe he might be in a decent spot. Those are not the spells he's looking for here.
They are not at all the spells he's looking for. Gundam Flame is going to go about his business.
Yep. He's going to need to find himself one more play here to fill out his curve. He's right now looking at Coin Animal Companion next turn, but not really anything to go with it. To then bridge the gap between that and Barnes. Unleash the Hounds really isn't that. So now Gun and Flame has a tricky decision on his hand. And I don't think this is a man that minds spending a turn pressing hero power too much.
Right, for all his aggression, he is also incredibly patient. Those two things don't often go together. So yeah, press that button, do 2 damage. And Oya needs a good pickup from this Raven Idol, or he's in a world of hurt.
Yep.
That's a good pickup.
Yeah, two Moonglow portals now, so he does have a lot of stabilization, but the real upside of Moonglow portal is that it actually gets you a board presence as well. You know, if his hand was a pile of healing touches right now,
yes.
it didn't do anything because Hunter is just going to stick huge minions to the board and beat you up. But the six drops that you get alongside that can actually start to contest you back on the board quite quickly.
So it seems likely that he's going to play Animal Companion into Barnes most of the time here.
Yeah.
The double quick shot's nice backup in hand, as are the dogs. So he should be able to force through quite a lot of damage with that Barnes and Animal Companion over the next three turns, even going through one of the Moonglades. It's the second Moonglade portal that might start to give him issues.
For sure. The bite pickup from Oya was probably picked up with precisely cards like Animal Companion and Barnes in mind. Huffer, with the texture of the hand here, is arguably one of the better ones, because what did he just pick up here to change his play? Picked up Nourish. He's going to Nourish for mana and now fit in the Wrath, which makes Huffer actually by far the weakest option.
Yep.
Because now that was worked out perfectly for Oya, where his Moonglade portals are now active and he's curving into Malagos fairly soon.
And Gundam Flame picking up the card he needed right now is that Savannah Highmane, just to keep the pressure on. He doesn't necessarily know it's the card he needed right now. He'd have settled for any biggish thing to play because his curve seems fine. But that is going to be the card that keeps him going through here for a while at least to come. But Oya's looking like he's going to be in a fine spot. And if he does play this Ancient of War, it'll be because there's a chance of healing it with a Moonglade portal after it kills something next turn.
Yeah. Definitely like the Ancient of War coming down first here. It looked like he was considering the Moonglade portal just to be mana efficient, so he could do Moonglade portal hero power into Ancient of War hero power. But for exactly the reason you just described, this gives him the flexibility of having more information about where to send the target of the Moonglade portal on the follow-up turn.
And that's another beauty of having two of them in your hand. If you've only got one, you probably consider having to use it on your own face. But having the second one means you can just kill a thing for free and make a heal and a six drop. And a random six drop is a lot better than the other random drops as well. Six drops are good things because they don't tend to have massive battle cries eating up the mana costs.
Yeah, there's just a nice pool of death rattles around that number as well. Your Sylvanas's and Cairns, of course, but also Wobbling Runts is just a really strong long-term value card that you can get there. It's a strong number for sure. This has been examined over a long time now through things like Master of Evolution to which numbers are good numbers for random outcomes, and six is a pretty positive one.
Yeah, there's a lot of sort of beefy taunt as well, which is exactly what you want now.
Sunwalker, Lord of the Arena, Dark Arakoa. So there's a lot of upside on six mana.
What I need to do, and I haven't done this and I'm sorry for it, is look what the whiffs are on six almost.
It's like Cabal Shadow Priest, Nerubian Prophet.
Right.
So
4/4, 4/5 in those instances.
Yeah,
okay.
Pretty much.
Which is okay.
Yep.
It's not what you want. That's why it's called a whiff. But as bad outcomes go, a random Yeti isn't too bad.
So the Abusive Sergeant picked up here gives him a little bit of flexibility with his turn, but no Deadly Shot. I'm not sure. I mean, I'm going to look at the list now, but before I get to it, I'm going to say that Oya might be a man aggressive enough to just cut Deadly Shot out of his list. And it does, in fact, look like, there is no Deadly Shot in this deck.
Wow.
There is a Carrion Grub in this deck where the Deadly Shot would be in most people's lists.
So going the other way from what we saw earlier, I assume there's double Houndmaster if you're playing Carrion Grub and really valuing getting everything you can out of that Houndmaster. And we don't care about Malagos because we can't do anything about it.
Yeah, he just has no option to interact with it. But Swipe here is going to be backbreaking. He has the Moonglade portal to follow it up with, which is going to secure his life total for the time being as well. So this is looking like Oya might have found the game where he climbs his way back onto the board.
Yeah, and he's going to proc the wolf first, so there's no terrifying board. There are going to be two twos hanging around after the swipe, and he wants to play the Moonglade portal, so he won't get to bite anything. I don't think he cares.
No, probably not. He's actually going to choose not to even swipe the high main. Swiping the high main actually only reduces 2 damage, so he's actually potentially just setting up lethal here for himself by swiping face. This is actually a strong recognition. Is that a Sea Reaver he's picked up? It looks like it, yeah. So 10 damage from his 2 minions on board, plus the bite, plus the hero power. So now, even though he doesn't quite have lethal, he has Malygos on the board right now, so his opponent pretty much has to respect his ability to have lethal in his hand.
Yeah, I mean, Gundam Flame is thinking that bite is swipe slash whatever right now. He's sure. Not expecting precisely bite, so has to find a way to kill something here. Or he can he set up next turn lethal and just take the whole you've got to have it route? It won't work because there'll be loads of heals from Oya anyway, but
no, I mean, so what, huge toad, kindly grandmother, press hero power, hit face for 4, you're dealing 6 this turn.
Actually,
your opponent's at 13.
You probably go huge toad, grandmother, as much as it pains you not to press the button, so then next turn you can actually empty your hand for the quick shot into kill command finish. If you go that route,
you're trying to end the turn end the game in 2 turns, right? So the 2 damage this turn,
so
is
you give up 1
the
damage.
Promise.
Does this actually set up lethal? 2, 3. Sure.
I think if you're trying to set up damage over 2 turns, then you always have to make hero power part of your mentality for both of those turns. Like the potential promise of an extra card draw.
Costs you one damage.
So the cost of missing damage is just not worth it, right? Sure. You'd just rather have that 2 damage straight away. So I think this is the right line. He definitely just doesn't really have any win condition if he starts sending damage into these minions. So
yeah,
he just has to pray that his opponent doesn't have it here. His opponent doesn't, but his opponent does just have more healing, which is going to function in the same way to lock him out.
Right. The reason I was thinking that line, what you said is obviously true, a large, if not almost all of the time. Mm-hmm. You give up precisely 1 damage, assuming the toad hits face, but you've given up. You're only doing 1 hero power instead of 2.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't do 13 without something else happening. So I think the 1 damage might not be worth anything, whereas the quick shot into more damage might have been. That's all I was thinking with that.
Sure, I mean, the addition here is that he chose to play both grandmothers instead of the huge toad, because of course the huge toad just gets traded on the board immediately, whereas the grandmothers are more awkward to deal with, so It's a complex proposition, for sure. He's going face here. Call of the Wild picked up means 5 damage from the Huffer. 6 on board is 11 plus 4 more.
What does Call of the Wild do?
15 damage.
Sure. Before anyone picks me up on that, I know what Call of the Wild does.
It summons 3 companions for the cost of 8 mana.
That seems like a fair deal.
Yeah.
Let's get myself some of those. And it is going to be 2-1. We can see here that Gundam Flame has no way out of this mess.
No, he can't even isolate a minion with the Houndmaster, right? Even if he could, then the bite plus hero power just goes through next turn anyway once the minion trades out the Taunted Beast. So Gundam Flame is going to go over all his options, try and find himself a win condition from his perspective that might get him out of this game, but doesn't look like he's going to find it.
This may be a little bit of confirmation bias because, you know, we see the same 4 decks in a lot of tournaments, but the Hunter seems to have been struggling for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And yet nobody in this top 4 is playing Zoo. Meaning, why aren't they playing Zoo instead of Hunter?
Right, but I mean, we saw people bringing Zoo yesterday, and the people who brought Zoo also struggled with their Zoo.
Yeah.
That was one of the notable stories of day one, so you know, it's a 5 deck format, and honestly, once you come down to a 5 deck format, there's almost always going to be one deck that you'd rather not have brought, and it sometimes also already gets to that point when it's a 4 deck format where one of your decks is I'm not entirely happy with this choice. So I think there's always the option for it to come down to that, but I think you know, Gundam Flames Hunter up until now has been performing pretty well.
Yes,
for him.
Yeah, and he is a very good aggressive player, as we've discussed. It just fascinates me that Zoo is a big part of the 4-deck format and seems to be struggling. Obviously, that's mainly pre-Karazhan. And a lot of people are saying how much better the Zoo deck is now Karazhan is out with the discard options.
Yeah.
And I think 5 out of 16 people brought it yesterday, you said, when you counted up, which means they didn't trust it as a group.
Mm-hmm.
And then none of those guys got through with it, which like reinforces the decision not to bring it. It's just odd to me that Hunter, which has been kind of ropey for a lot of these players, is still considered better than Zoo. I'm just trying to work out exactly which matchups. Maybe they're rating Druid as so powerful they need the Hunter to have a go. Even though Zoo,
I looked at this briefly last night, and I think all but one of the Zoo players went out in the first round. One Zoo got through to the second round, and none of the Zoos made it to this stage, the semifinals. The one Warlock deck that got through to the semifinals is Oya's Handlock deck. So Warlock, the people who chose not to bring it, the majority that chose not to bring it, definitely seem to have been in the right on that one.
Yeah. No, I'm not disputing the rightness of it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just curious as to what has changed. And again, maybe it's different in best of seven to best of five, though I can't quite feel why that would be either. So no doubt it'll become apparent over the coming weeks. Again, there are three championship series here on Play Hearthstone over the next 3 weeks. I always forget the order of NA and Europe. I'm sure you can put me right.
It's America's first, followed by Europe.
And then APAC, which the winner of this event will be at. So get to see all three championship events, winners of all three of those events, of course, progress to BlizzCon. And we're into game four, so enough of me rambling on.
Yeah, and just to quickly wrap up on the Zoo point, I think the one big deal that means people might not trust it in tournament formats at the moment is that you used to bring it into your tournament format because you could use it to pick up a win against Aggro Shaman.
Right.
With like real consistency,
yes.
Right? Like, you know, you had to ban Warrior if someone was bringing an Aggro Shaman Dragon Warrior lineup, because Dragon Warrior was the apex predator amongst all of those three aggressive decks.
Mm-hmm.
And that left the Shaman up, and then you used your Zoo to try and beat it. But now, with Spirit Claw's Maelstrom Portal in Shaman decks, they are now favored against Zoo, which means that the Zoo falls down the pecking order of that, you know, predatorial
yes.
line in terms of those powerful decks. So I can understand people dropping it out, even though overall, as a ladder deck against the field, it's still looking immensely powerful.
And that card is a Baron Geddon in Dragon Warrior. And this Dragon Warrior, Sottle, is a greedy list.
Oya's Dragon Warrior, yes indeed. Let's go through the late game cards. So starting at 6 mana, he has 1 Draconid Crusher, 1 Baron Geddon, 1 Malkarak, 1 Grommash Hellscream, 1 Ragnaros Firelord, and 1 Deathwing.
That is a confident man.
Enormous amount of late game in this deck. No Nazoth's First Mate, 1 Fairy Dragon. So he has, it's literally at the cost of his early game that he's playing these late game cards.
And how would that line up against Druid, do you feel? I mean, it seems to me like that might not be the worst idea against Druid, where, you know, I'm just going to go toe-to-toe with you late on. But the problem is you're going toe-to-toe with 6 mana against 9 or something a lot of the time.
Yeah, I mean, sure, Baron Geddon is a card that can be helpful in the Druid matchup for sure against, you know, Violet Teacher Power of the Wild boards, right? Like,
yeah.
It seems like a card that's probably playable in the meta for that reason alone, that Violet Teacher Power of the Wild tends to snowball so many games. So I can see it happening, but it's just, as you say, like, can Druid just get their mana to a point where you just don't have 7 to answer it on the turn that they make it happen?
And we saw Baron Geddon yesterday in Druid in one of the decks as well. And that was interesting. That seemed like what you just said was good for that particular deck, at least, as an interesting piece of tech. Using the coin, having to use the coin in a greedy deck. We didn't have to use it either.
Yeah, he could have just played the Frothing Berserker on curve, but using the coin here, going coin in 4 into 4 with, you know, mm-hmm. huge amounts of health. Basically, you know, any minion with above, say, 5 health that doesn't die to like swipe hero power immediately starts to demand, you know, a mulch from a Druid opponent, because Druids just struggle with high health removal. They just don't do it very well. So his
Hence
plan here
Yogg.
Is... Yeah, exactly. Hence Yogg's are on in the deck. So Oya's plan here is just to load up the board with as much health as he can as quickly as possible and just try and force Druid onto the back foot.
Right, Gundam Flame. I just whenever I watch him, I just think the first thing he's thinking about is, can I ignore that?
Well, no, because it has Taunt.
No, but can I ignore it and just like play my Azure Drake and just forget that thing's there? He's going to mulch it.
Yeah, and reminder, he has just used a mulch on a 4-drop against the Baron Geddon, Ragnaros, Grommash, Hellscream, Deathwing deck. I don't think this is going to work out too well for him in the long run.
On the other side, it means you can't mulch him into something big that's going to kill you, because he's already got those things in his deck.
Right, and you know, the extra downside of that mulch as well is that it's not a mulch that netted him any tempo. He didn't gain any advantage through that mulch whatsoever, where you can pressure your opponent to say, you know, I'm going to use this three mana removal to gain a bunch of tempo by killing a big thing, and then I'm going to be so far ahead on the board that your big clunky cards don't have any impact on the game. That's just nowhere near the situation that he's in right now. So that mulch is very potentially going to spell his downfall in this game.
Yeah, and have you ever seen Wilfred Fizzlebang reduce the cost of a card in a tournament setting?
Let's go with no.
Because that can happen here. There's Finley in this deck.
That is true. Yeah, hang on. I was about to say, wait, if you're about to say, like, Finley Slam, then no, that doesn't work. But you are absolutely correct. He could get Life Tap here.
I'm not sure that's the thing that's going to happen, obviously, but hey, we can wish for these weird things to happen. That's why the cards are in the decks in the first place, like mulch. But Gundam Flame, for that to happen, is going to have to find a way to survive long enough for Finley to even be drawn by his opponent, because things are starting to look a bit bleak, given that we know Oya's deck is really, really heavy.
Yeah, I mean, he is odds on from now to draw something big and playable every single turn. Just because of the amount of heavy stuff that he has in his deck. He hasn't hit any of his 5 drops yet. He hasn't hit any of his 6 drops. He hasn't hit any of his 7 plus drops, apart from the ones that he's curving into now. So there is a Grom, a Rag, 2 Drakes, 2 Blackwing Corruptors, 1 Draconid Crusher. All of this stuff is left in his deck that he can use to just curve out consistently now on every turn and put pressure on this Druid.
And in fairness to Oya, if this was a normal Dragon Warrior deck, Gundam Flame would be in a really good spot right now. He's about to clear up, still got a handful of druid things to do. And you know, Dragon Warrior would be starting to run out of stuff about now. But this isn't a normal Dragon Warrior. This is a Dragon Warrior that's just going to keep on spewing out stuff, and it's going to be big and terrifying.
And there is a Wilfred Fizzlebang. If I have one regret in my life, Lorinda, it's that we are not currently watching this with sound, and I still don't know what Wilfred Fizzlebang's Japanese entrance sound sounds like.
You could probably Google that later, though.
I could.
Just to spoil your train there.
Can't you just allow me to have regrets?
I'm sure you've got plenty already to deal with, Sotter. We won't give you more regrets.
Thanks, buddy.
It's okay, dude. Gundam Flame refusing to go away in this game, though. Plenty of stuff going on here, and I wonder if he's already thinking about how to feed a big Yogg, even though he has a massive hand. Assuming he knows about his opponent's deck list.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we don't have 100% information on that, but given we're being shown things are being shown on screens, there's a good chance that they know each other's lists.
Yeah, I think the fact that they're being put on stream is the tipping point. I was a little bit concerned yesterday that we were giving away information about decks when we hadn't had it confirmed to us that the players actually knew. But yeah, once they're being shown on stream, I think I'm pretty confident we are working in a revealed deck lists format here.
So with that in mind, it may be that he already has to start working towards the Yogg, because despite the fact his hand is terrific at this point, normally, again, going back to that heavy deck thing, he may find that Yogg is his win condition this time around and just use this stuff to stay alive.
All right, Malkorok coming down here. He did use the mulch minion, the Wilfred Fizzlebang, to fill the gap that he needed there. He did whiff a little bit, picking up Blackwing Corruptor with no real target for it. So now that Wilfred Fizzlebang has filled the gap, he is now curving into some of his pressure plays with the Malkorok. And this huge druid hand... Normally, any other class, you look at a hand this big and you say, you know, there's no way they're going to be able to spend all these cards by the end of the game. But druids, through usage of, you know, Emperor Thorasan and Innovate, etc., they can dump a hand incredibly quickly.
So what he takes here will show us how he's feeling about this game. If he takes the healing, he obviously feels the game can go long.
Mm-hmm.
And so on and so on. As you move down that chain, the more he's thinking about the game. I don't think we're saying team take the Nourish. If he takes that, then we think he's digging for Yogg, I guess. But I imagine we'll see him take the portal here. And just try and go long, clear everything up, then gain 6 health and try and survive to Yogg.
Yeah, it looks like the plan. I mean, he's definitely not the play this turn. He has to react to this board. It's just
I'm talking like 4 turns.
No, I know. I'm just saying, like, this turn he has to use as a stabilizing play completely. But
I guess the Moonglade Portal is potentially what he needs. He's actually going to choose not to remove and actually go for board tension instead. This is interesting to me.
I guess that means that whatever survives this next turn, in terms of both sides of the board, he will be able to use his removal much more correctly. Lots more information about what trades are going to happen in this game is revealed by putting the stuff on the board now and making those trades forced right now.
I'm also interested by the decision to generate the 2-2 again. Even though it's only a ramp of one mana in this situation, the 2-2 does just die, as you can see, to the free 2-2 weapon from Oya. And ramping himself up to 10 mana means that he can then draw with both of those wild growths, getting himself four spells in the process, in a game that we've pretty much established may very well just be a Yogg game, right? So drawing two cards and playing four spells in the process seems to be a pretty solid line.
Yeah, and other things like Violet Teacher into Moonglade Portal, definitely things he might want to do as well if he had that extra point of mana.
Yeah.
So definitely would have had more options, but also this way has saved him two health in the short term. And now he needs things. He needs help.
Trades the Wilfred. The Finley into Lifetap dream is dead, I'm afraid. But the dream of qualifying for the APAC Championships is well and truly alive, because it looks like he's about to climb himself back into an even series here, unless Gundam Flame can turn this immense amount of value in his hand into some sort of presence on the board, some sort of swing in the game.
Yeah, trying to see if he can actually clear up here with... not he can't clear, but something like Blood Mage into Wrath, into Living Roots and Moonfire. That can take down a 9-9 trade into the 3-2, maybe. I mean, I'm not mathsing. I refuse to maths at this point with so much going on.
Blood Mage Wrath plus a Moonfire plus the 3-3 will kill the 9-9. And then... yeah, it's awkward. He can use all three and then trade the 3-3 into the 3-2, as you said.
Sneaky Teacher
actually work.
Sneaky Teacher
does actually work here as well, yeah. But that still leaves the small matter of the 6-5 hanging around. But he has, in fact, found a way to get himself some tempo back on this board.
Okay.
Wait, what?
Miscounted. He thought that was... Yeah, he's just miscounted, and the shame concede comes out.
We've officially cursed Gundam Flame, haven't we?
Yeah, he's now turned into rank 25 Flame.
That is the first thing anywhere approaching a mistake that Gundam Flame has made this tournament.
And he worked the whole turn out, and then just either pressed the wrong button or, you know, brain seizure or something. And let's see how he copes with that, because that is, as you say, his first misplay, and players who don't misplay much feel them a lot more than me.
I mean, he still had a really, really, really uphill struggle in that game.
Yeah, he was dead as it happens, because the 5-4 was in hand of the other player, he had lethal anyway, I think.
What, just with the 6-5 on the board?
So that would have been... oh, he would kill the 3-2 as well?
Yeah, he would have killed the 9-9
then fine.
3-2.
Then he didn't have lethal. Sorry.
Interesting. Okay. Anyway, I mean, regardless of that, it was still a huge uphill struggle, because he still had to beat the Deathwing that game after the mulch had gone. So, having already dealt so much damage through in the first place, and whenever he really chose to use the Deathwing, it would have been threatening lethal yet again. So it didn't look like a game he was too likely to win most of the time. But still, you can see still in his face, head in his hands there, just as he was talking to the admin, he's definitely feeling that mistake. So. Hopefully he can get back to the level of play that we saw yesterday and at least make a fight of this series, because if he continues to make mistakes like that, then Oya is clearly at least a good enough player to be able to capitalize on them.
He's a good enough player, but he still has the elephant in the room. He has the Handlock deck to find a win with somewhere.
He does, and it's a deck that struggled, honestly. It took him three bites at the cherry. He was 3-0 up in his quarterfinals game with just the Handlock left to win with, and it took him three attempts to get that done. And I honestly think in the third game that he won, the opponent made a pretty big mistake that kind of opened the door to allow him to do that. So
yeah, Zenith was playing Mage in that match and sort of started clearing minions rather than just winning the game.
Well, what he developed a second mana worm into the Hellfire.
That's phase, right, yeah.
Instead of just riding his one mana worm plus burn.
And then the Hellfire came down on curve.
Yeah. And then bad things happened. Because it was his last minion in hand, essentially. And he could, like, he already had a 3-3 mana worm on the board. He could have just torched face for 3 mana. Instead, he spent 3 mana developing a mana worm, which I just really disagree with. So he kind of opened the door for Oya to pick up a win with the Handlock in that game, in my opinion. So it remains to be seen whether Oya's Handlock is able to, you know, really contest wins at a high level on its own here.
Yeah, and if your other deck is Handlock, and I don't like the pick order discussion very often at all, but getting your opponent's Hunter out of the way seems like a thing you might as well try and do. Yeah, so sure. We'll see. You don't want to, yeah, whatever. Take the 50-50 now, basically.
You've opened the floodgates.
I've done it again, right? I love it.
So Argent Squire picked up from Gun and Flame here, which is going to do nicely contesting this Fiery Bat. He now has the decision of A, if he's playing a minion this turn, B, if he wants to go for the Dream with the Kindly Grandmother, and then attack into the Fiery Bat to try and pop it open and get his 3-2 on the board to contest immediately. C, whether he'd rather have that 1-1 from the Kindly Grandmother on the board anyway. And then D, if he's going with an alternate line like Huge Toad or Coin Animal Companion, would he rather make that play first so that he's reducing the chances of his Argent Squire dying?
Yep, I got all that.
I mean, this is
turn two and right, so many decisions.
Exactly. This is considered a, you know, honestly, a pretty simple matchup. These are considered simple decks to play. They just kind of try and curb out and kill the opponent as best they can, but that is the level of decision that you're looking at on turn two in a simplistic matchup in this game. Hearthstone is pretty hard.
Oh, gets the roll he wants there. So that looks good, but now do you just take the free kill with the Toad or do you try and kill both things? Or do you just run the Hound in, I guess, while they're both on one health?
I think I like the trade into the 1-1 here. Interesting. He's going to use the Unleash the Hounds. I guess he had no other play that turn, so yeah, the Unleash the Hounds.
Oh, okay, sure. Right. Yeah, just think, what other play is going to make? Yeah, good call. So,
Because like if he was able to develop a minion there, I would have liked the trade into the 1-1 because you're almost guaranteed to pick up both trades with the Huge Toad anyway because your opponent has to respect your Houndmaster. So the trade is going to come back the other way anyway. You don't need to risk missing the Death Rattle pop, taking out the Argent Squire. So if he had another minion to develop, I think I would have liked seeing the trade into the 1-1. But since he didn't, Unleash the Hounds is just obviously the cleanest play.
Thought there for a second he might quick shot this Toad as well this turn and give up the coin and play off curve. Because he's playing the Carrion Grub himself, maybe one if he'd respect the Houndmaster more than most players. But just sticking on curve here, kind of.
This is interesting. Oya looking like he's going to turn down his own Houndmaster here. The Houndmaster does only put his Huge Toad up to 3 health, which is vulnerable to a kill command, it's vulnerable to a counter Houndmaster, and it's vulnerable to a quick shot.
Right, and he kept the quick shot, Sottle, last turn.
He did.
And if the Houndmaster had come down, the quick shot would have got so much value.
Very
Oya has dodged it.
And he did pick up the Houndmaster as well, which would have been an even more crushing play, honestly, because he could have tempoed out with it as well. So this is actually a really strong line of play from both players.
Yeah,
right now.
Loving it. And the only thing there is Gundam Flame may have seen that pickup. I know that players do sometimes bluff, but in general, Gundam Flame will have an idea the Houndmaster is there now. Not that it's going to matter, because it's going to get played soon anyway. But
so questions to be asked here are Tundra Rhino has a lot of upside. Houndmaster just creates a 1-for-1 trade on the board, 5-5 into 5-4.
This clears everything.
This clears everything and leaves a 2-1 Tundra Rhino on the board that needs to be answered here, or you're charging a Savannah High Main at them next turn.
Yeah, and it'll probably get answered. But the high main into the kept back Houndmaster, which has dodged this quick shot. There's been a lot going on in this game. Looks like it's going to get a lot of value in a couple of turns time, no matter what happens to the high main. And
that
yes,
is the
nice.
Only potential punish for Oya there being greedy and making the attacks to face. I'm kind of on board, honestly, with the attacks going through to face, because he does have such a huge health initiative right now, and leveraging a health advantage is a really big deal in this Hunter matchup.
Oh,
we saw we saw Gundam Flame in a previous game, or in a previous series. Oh, no, it was in our first series, in fact, where the player was just able to just go face and leave his opponent at one because of the health advantage that he'd had early on. And that is a really big deal in this matchup. So I do like Hoya taking the initiative, but the Leok is the only real direct punish for that.
And that second animal companion, really cheeky. If he rolls Misha with that, then he would have been in such a great position. Like, he left up the 6-1 versus the 1-1. Situation and just goes right. If I roll Misha Hill 5-1 versus 1-1, everything goes crazy. And if I don't, then I get the trade that was going to happen anyway. So,
Rolls Huffer is not a great outcome here. He doesn't really have the damage to back this up. Although, with the Houndmaster coming down, he does get to push 6 this turn if he wants to. I don't think Huffer is built for trading. Huffer is built for going directly to the face, but still 12 damage away. If he doesn't pick up extra damage from hand, that is 6 hero powers that he's got to find a way through if his opponent has an answer to this board.
Right, and Gundam Flame at this point, first of all, has to decide, can I ever beat Call of the Wild?
Mm-hmm.
If I can beat Call of the Wild, I have to play differently. If I can't, then sure, I play what turns out to be correctly, because there is no Call of the Wild. And I think he's going to quickly reach the decision that Call of the Wild beats him a huge percentage of the time here and play accordingly, which may mean developing a high main.
No, I don't think you ever develop a high main here.
You don't.
If you develop a high main, you take damage next turn. If you take damage next turn, you never race the hero power. If that Houndmaster gets to hit you in the face, you just almost never beat the hero power clock. So you have to take 0 damage this turn and then hope that through taking 0 damage that turn, you can now develop the high mains and push back. This is about the best possible hand that Oya could have, double Kindly Grandmother. He picked up Infested Wolf, which actually represents damage here, to be able to race him. But, you know, Gundam Flame found himself a line where if my opponent's hand is Kindly Grandmother, Argent Squire, then maybe I can win the game. And it was pretty close to working.
And he has a lot of information about Oya's hand here.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how that helps him, because he's kind of dying, but I'm just pausing while I work out what I think is better with this 2 damage.
It's going face.
No, I mean whether you use the hero power, whether you hold on to the abusive and use him next turn. But developing,
oh, I see. I think there's one Argent Horse Rider in Gundam Flames' deck. He's going to have minions on board most of the time anyway, so it is just going to be a pure race situation. So front-loading the abusive sergeant now does actually net him 2 damage, because he gets his 2 damage, and then he gets the 2 damage a turn from the abusive sergeant a turn earlier as well, so...
He has perfect information, but he won't be happy with the information he has got unless he draws Unleash the Hounds.
He needs Houndmaster, Call of the Wild, Unleash the Hounds. These are the things that keep him in the game. That's a Houndmaster. That is huge. That is unbelievably good for him here.
So having a 7 health high main is a thing he can do that his opponent can't currently get through.
There is only 7 power on the board, which means all of this damage goes downtown, right? It just has to, I think.
I think you're right. He may be looking at taking out one of the grandmothers if he can get away with it, because of the fiery bat. He just wants to double check that he can't do that for safety, but I don't think he can afford to.
Any damage kills him, right? The only removal card that the hunter can draw that doesn't kill him is Deadly Shot. So, go on.
I was just thinking that if the high main dies, he may not have lethal anymore, and he can take down the grandmother here. So if he takes down one of the grandmothers, he keeps the high main alive. Which is 4 extra damage next turn, but it's 5 that you miss this turn, so he...
No, if he pushes face, he does have lethal if the high main dies. So you push face. Oh, never mind.
it all became a formality in the end because damage was picked up. But yeah, what I was about to say is that any removal that is picked up kills you.
Yeah.
Right? Because Deadly Shot is the only card in the deck that doesn't do that. So you just have to like base your play purely off the board. And if that entire board trades into your high main, you win the game by sending the damage face in the way that he does.
Right. And the other way worked too, though. If the entire board trades your high main and it doesn't die, the 8 damage kills it. So it's one of those decisions that you check one way works, and if it works, you go for it, I think.
Sure.
I suspect that we're both arguing the opposite end of something that works 100% of the time.
Yeah, seems good, but I mean, I made the call that we've spent so long talking about how impressed we were by Gundam Flame.
And now he can't win a game.
We will have cursed him out of this tournament, and that is very close to becoming a reality. So we certainly won't have made too many friends in the Japanese scene. Well, one at least. We were made friends with Oya anyway. But apart from that, it looks like we have put the infamous caster curse onto Gundam Flame, unless he can get back to the lofty heights of play that we saw in the first series that we witnessed yesterday and climb back from a deficit now after looking so comfortable at 2-0 up.
Right. And Oya having the thing we talked about a couple of times, though. Handlock versus Hunter, Handlock versus Yogdruid. Two matchups I suspect Handlock doesn't revel in particularly.
I mean, I'm not sure what matchups the Handlock does revel in, honestly. I just don't see it as a powerful deck, but Oya has brought it here as one of the best 5 options he can bring. He obviously does have a penchant for a little bit of greed and a little bit of control in his decks because, you know, he's brought Dragon Warrior because it's an insanely powerful deck. You'd be crazy not to bring it, right?
And if you don't pay attention when you're looking through the deck list, you think it's Control Warrior.
Right, and he's packed it full of late game. He has a Baron Geddon in there. His Yogdruid, again, incredibly powerful deck. You're kind of crazy not to bring it, but he has 2 Ancient of Wars in there. It's about as controlling as you can get. So he's obviously a player who favors these controlling decks. So, I mean, this might just be a comfort pick, a flavor pick for him, but if this series is going to go awry for him, there is only one way it can go awry for him now because the Handlock is the only deck and it's going to come down yet again to can he pick up a win with this Handlock.
So interesting in this mulligan that he chooses to keep, or is looking to keep, the Refreshment Vendor but not the Farseer.
Mm-hmm.
Is that just because the body is such a good shape against Hunter?
So if you... The curve of like playing Doomsayer on 2 into Farseer on 3 will, you know, probably... Okay, first things first, your opponent could drop Kindly Grandmother into it, which means they then have a 3-2 on the board to trade into your 3-3.
Yep.
So it's kind of useless. Secondly, they can answer your 3-3 Farseer with an Animal Companion, which has 4 health a lot of the time, so your Farseer is kind of useless. Thirdly, if you go down that line, you're going to be missing out on Life Tap, which means you're low on resources. You can't just curve out every turn. You do have to find some sort of way to tap and get some resources in your hand. So short answer, yes. The way it lines up, you'd rather tap on turn 3 and play a body on turn 4 then play a body on turn 3 and tap on turn 4.
And basic Hearthstone question, how good is a 4/7 on turn 3?
It's pretty strong.
Because that's honestly what Gundam Flame's representing right now.
Wait, a 4/7 on turn 3?
Carrion Grub is a 4/7 on turn 3 as far as I'm concerned in this hand.
Oh, I see. Right, yeah, I'm with you.
But just pointing out the tech choice and why it's there. That is effectively 4 points of attack on turn 3 coming in.
Not anymore.
But now the whole dream is ruined.
And that
6/9.
That makes a complete mess of the entire hand.
Yeah. The hand that looked gorgeous just a moment ago.
The saving grace here, and again, it's just the power of Kindly Grandmother, right, is that he's retaining a 3-2 beast on the board. So the 3-5 Refreshment Vendor here, if it comes down, is going to get punished incredibly hard.
Right, and actually the curve doesn't work out too terribly, because turn 5, Carrion Grub, Hero Power, turn 6, Houndmaster, Hero Power, those aren't terrible-looking turns for the most part, although we can see that the Handlock hand is getting kind of scarily good at the moment.
Uh-oh. Looks like Oya has run into the latency issues that have been cursing Gundam Flame a little bit. His coin has disappeared and not
just
granted
no
in the
coin
manner
for you.
There we go. It's appeared. We found it. So it is going to be the refreshment vendor this turn, and this is just going to get zipped up in a black body bag right now by this Houndmaster.
Yeah, showing exactly why this card is so good. No reason not to trade. If you ignore Handlock too much, things can go wrong horribly. Well, five to face is a lot, I guess.
Remember, we are talking about Gundam.
Right. Here.
If you say the words "no reason not to trade,"
he
you
won't
be
trade.
Really,
yeah, good
damn
point.
Confident.
Yeah, and he chooses to trade, but like you say, got to be careful with that because five to face would have been a lot as well.
And Sun Fury Protector here just being played out for tempo, and it's just a thought of trying to soften up these minions so that Shadow Flame can be effective later on. He just doesn't want too much health appearing on the board that he's not able to deal with. This is a free trade on the board for the Houndmaster, so it's honestly just he basically wants his opponent to attack it, right? He just wants it to heal him for four.
This is an incredibly difficult turn. I mean, play things, go face is the Hunter meme, and that's what he's done, but he could have played pretty much any of the castable cards in his hand legitimately there. But he's put down the board that's the hardest to get rid of going into another Houndmaster turn, and that makes sense. And is Oya calling for admin again?
Looks like
it. Or is he calling for an ambulance?
The Spectator client does seem to have reconnected, and he's back in it. It looks more like he's just in the considering his plays, thinking emoji stance now, rather than the concerned calling from an admin stance. So I think he will have reconnected to the game. He's just considering his options here, and he might be considering his options for a while because none of them look too great.
Yeah, and this is not a Reno deck, guys. So if Gundam Flame puts him to one in next turn, that's a lot of problems.
Yeah.
Just to remind you guys, it's not Reno. Just in case I didn't just say that 2 seconds ago. Reno deck here, the Hunter has all sorts of issues about putting you to one. Handlock, you just do it without a second thought. And that now represents all manners of lethal.
Ooh, Shadow Bowl. That is pretty much the only card that he could have tapped into here, which would have given him a chance of stabilizing. But damage, minions, Call of the Wild on 8. There is everything left in Gundam Flame's hand to be able to finish this game off. And Oya has already used one of his refreshment benders, which is his small incremental healing. And I talked about how much this deck misses Sludge Belcher, misses Antique Healbot. I just don't see how it survives exactly this kind of push in the mid game from all the aggressive tempo decks in the meta.
Right, and down to 3-3. And I mean, Yogg-Druid isn't particularly a tempo deck, but unfortunately, it depends how you define tempo, because he's going to have like so much more mana against a guy with lots of cards, and that kind of works out as tempo in the long run, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, he's playing a pretty tempo-heavy version of the deck. You know, he's still playing the Double Teacher, Double Pyro of the Wild package, which some people are cutting from the Mali deck for extra things like Moonglade Portal, but he's still trying to push the initiative. He still has those early curves, and he still has the ability to threaten a lot of burst damage, you know, not even just late in the game from Malygos, but just through combinations of swipes and Living Roots. If there's no initiative on the board from the Handlock, which there rarely is, because they're spending too long trying to scramble and answer things, then suddenly those swipes and those Living Roots are just reserved to be pointed at the face.
Yeah. And cuts down the number of taps like every deck does. You're playing a deck with revolves around its tap that's scared to tap. But he's playing it for a reason, and he's in the semi-final. So he's seeing something good in this deck, and it is Conquest. You pointed this out yesterday. It's Conquest, so it's been winning somewhere.
Yeah, and like I said, the game that we didn't see his round of 16 match, we saw his round of 8 match, and in that series, the deck won by his opponent, rightly or wrongly, taking the foot off the gas and just hedging back on the aggression a little bit, trying to go for board development instead of outright damage. I don't think we're going to see Gundam Flame do that. I think this is a man that has a thirst for blood, and he is just going to push through as hard as he can, as quickly as he can.
Right, and we did see in that last game, and we keep emphasising his aggressive nature, he did make a trade when 5-to-face was viable, despite the fact I said it wasn't. So
It wasn't viable, and then it was again.
Yeah, then I was terrified when I thought about it.
Yeah.
But so he isn't just a Smork man. He just favours that style of play.
Yeah.
And he does say in his notes that his notes are basically that his favourite class is Shaman, which again is Smork orientated class, as you all know. And the other thing that we both, I think, comfortable with as a strong sign of a strong player is, I came here last time, I didn't do very well, I'm here to do better. Mm-hmm. And he definitely is trying to do that, and probably already has.
So this is for the spot in the finals. The winner of this game will be one series away for a spot in the APAC Championships, which will then seed him through to BlizzCon if he is victorious at that event. So this is a huge game for both of these. And the decision for Oya to make this huge game rely on Handlock of all decks. Zero Molten Giant, zero Healbot, Belcher's gone. It's a very different deck. Faceless Shambler is really your leverage tool these days. But the decision for him to bring this deck to this tournament, everything is on the line now based on that decision.
And Gundam Flame's hand looks pretty tasty. It's got not much in it, but it's one of those hands that would just, whatever he draws pretty much will develop into a good hand because it has all the bases it needs. It has the removal, it has the card draw, and it has, of course, the ramp that you always want. So this can quickly turn into a nice hand.
Yeah, it hasn't got too much in it, but it does have a wild growth smack bang in the center of it, which pretty much qualifies it as a good opening hand for a druid.
Yeah.
Gundam Flame's options here, none of these are ideal. Force of Nature against a deck that plays double Hellfire, probably not something you're too happy about, but are the other two options, Starfire and Bite, are they really that much more promising?
Starfire against a deck that can't heal much, that taps. I like it as a closer.
I think he might have been considering Bite for the same reason.
Yeah.
I think, like, the thought process there, Bite is a little bit more efficient on damage. You know, it's one damage per mana where Starfire is just below that. But this is a taunt deck, right? They don't heal very well. They do taunt very well. So having the Starfire to bypass that is potentially a big deal.
And the draw card aspect is also kind of helpful because it draws a card. I give up. So, no, because he hasn't got a hand particularly full of gas, so if it really became an emergency, just smash you in the face on turn six and get something else. But it shouldn't ever come to that with Druid. You have so much stuff that draws you cards and so much mid-range that you should be okay.
Yeah. Blood Mage Hero Power Pass for me this turn. His hand is just, after that wild growth, it's not really got him the options that he needs, so he needs to cycle that Blood Mage, in my opinion. It's going to drop the power of the wild as well for tempo. This is Gundam Flame really being aggressive here.
Yeah, and why not, right? So, looks like he hasn't, because he's had patience in other games, but looks like he's assessed that this is just not going to get any value whilst the board is still relevant and wants to put something down there right now. And that's a lovely pickup now.
It is. It doesn't really provide him with amazing options for dealing with the Twilight Drake. I don't think he can Moonfire it for three and then trade in four. So no, he has no option to trade with it this turn. So he's going to have to just let it do its thing and pick up its value in trades one by one. But there is that Shadow Flame in hand for Oya if he feels like he's in an emergency situation already. But with tools like Shadow Bolt and Doomsayer and now a little bit of incremental healing with the Farseer and the Refreshment Vendor in hand, I don't think we'll be seeing a panic Shadow Flame anytime soon. This is looking like a better game for the Handlock, you have to say.
It certainly is, and especially with Gundam Flame's hand, before that Azra Drake at least, looking pretty ropey, it is still a hand that can... I mean, Druid is just a deck where your hand develops so well a lot of the time, but as Druid hands go, it's one of the ones that hasn't developed too well, but all these glowing cards with spell damage represent a way back into the game, I think, for him here.
They do. So that Starfire could potentially come into play here. 5 health on both these minions, so he could just Starfire one of them down cleanly, but the swipe also does 5 on the primary target. So it's really going to be down to him what he wants to go with here, and it looks like he's going to bypass both of those options.
He may draw with his wrath and then swipe.
Draw with the Wrath, swipe, and then trade the Blood Mage, I guess, is the line. Yeah, sure, this seems fine.
Keep your cards coming to keep up with the Warlock whilst, you know, make him do stuff. But Emperor Thorasan is going to put a whole new complexity and a whole new texture to this game, I think, if he wants to play that right now. Just, we talked about Maya Keeper making a 5-mana 2-2.
I think, yeah, just to interrupt you for a second, I think this is going to be a removal turn for him. I'd like to see the Doomsayer drop here. He's going to go with the Farseer, but I like his recognition because I talked about this in the previous series. You get into a situation there where if you play Emperor Thorasan and just leave a minion on board, suddenly if that minion connects face again, you're in that awkward position where you don't have the healing in your deck to stabilize over the course of the game, right? You've just taken too much damage. So I like that being a removal turn, and I would have liked to see the Doomsayer just so you get an empty board Emperor coming down.
Right,
the previous
so turn. I felt the same way when you started correcting me. I think, okay, so it's Doomsayer for Thorasan then, and for that reason you just said, you need to play Thorasan. If you're going to play on an empty board, there's your chance to get your empty board.
Yeah.
If you're not going to play on an empty board, you might as well have played it last turn.
Right, Farseer has the potential to, you know, sometimes do the same sort of thing. It can, like, try and contest the board that your opponent is going to make here, but, like, most of the time it's not going to be good enough. So
especially against a druid that's been doing very little in the opening turns. Right. You've got to suspect that Farseer is not long for this world.
Yeah, I personally think it's a pretty big oversight from Oya's part to not play the Doomsayer there, going with the Farseer instead.
So Malygos represents 13 damage on turn 10.
It does.
Will we see a Starfire randomly to face in one of the next two turns?
I mean, that will set off the alarm bells for sure. Ideally, he wants to pick up a third Malygos card here so that he can deal more than 15. Then he can be as aggressive as he likes, because then he plays around the only burst healing that Oya does have, which is Alexstrasza and Jiraxxus.
He can also Maya Keeper for mana to set that up for next turn and put some damage into face. He can still put 5 to face to 18. Maya Keeper for mana. But yeah, he's going to go for the more sensible play. But
and now this exact situation, which I was saying that Oya needs to try and avoid, is happening. The Emperor was dropped, but because the minions are still in play, this damage being pushed through now puts Oya in really serious danger of just dying to straight up reach from Gundam Flame's hand.
Yeah, and this is, I was going to say this is why Malygos is in this deck. Yeah, for beating Handlock. Okay, that's not quite fair. But it's one of the reasons in this deck is for beating control decks in general. And we don't see that use of it very often because we don't see control decks very often in the current meta. But this reach goes from decent to ridiculous incredibly quickly here.
Yeah, he's going to be looking for that second Moonfire for another Living Roots. Still has Raven Idols to help him pick up stuff as well, so there is a lot of potential damage here for Oya, for Gundam Flame, sorry. Oya, though, will be perhaps like snap-picking voodoo doctors here if he's offered them, but just gets three high-value... I mean, they're four heal each. There's a Cran on the board. He would straight up be snap-picking voodoo doctors.
No, I'm laughing because of what we've said all day is that this deck seems like it doesn't have healing, and now we're talking about snap-picking voodoo doctor
power
because...
Power overwhelming is a huge deal. Sorry to cut you off, but Power Overwhelming and Shadow Flame here means that he can use the Peddler to board clear, keep the Bran on the board for more initiative later, but that Innovate is now a big deal as well, because that means if he can start to get some discounts on this hand, he can fit in things like Swipe into the burst damage with Malygos as well. That's a Fandral Staghelm, meaning Fandral Innovate Wrath here is going to retake the board for Gundam Flame. This game is really close. Gundam Flame just needs to keep drawing here, find those extra points of damage that he needs.
And he literally only needs either Moonfire or Living Roots because of that Innovate, I believe.
Yeah.
That might be 17, but 17 would be fine, I think, because the Fandral's not going anywhere unless damage is done to both players. With the Hellfire.
Considering the Innovate power of the world here, for sure, just as to whether he wants to generate some board presence. He's used one Violet Teacher already, which is obviously his best card with Power of the Wild, so it does really give him a convincing lethal setup on the board, right? If he generates the extra Panther right now, just with Malygos, Living Roots, and Moonfire on the following turn.
And trusting like in the rope.
Oh, that's true, yeah, with the amount of latency issues that we've seen.
Yeah, trusting that it's all going to be fine. I guess he thinks he's far enough in front. And there is that Hellfire I was talking about. And now, any pickup at all would be lethal. Well, sorry, it needs Moonfire to be lethal. But it's looking so good for him with so little cards left in the Warlock's hand and the Warlock not able to tap.
That's a Moonfire! Off the top, the Moonfire being picked up. Hanlock falling at the last hurdle for Oya again. Gundam Flame books his spot in the finals. And we have to beg the question, Lorinda, is Hanlock really the right deck to bring to a high-level tournament like this?
We thought it yesterday. I mean, it's not in hindsight. When it scraped through that quarterfinal yesterday, it definitely looked ropey. And just every single matchup looks like it's going to lose.
Yeah.
Even the ones it won, it sort of looked like it was going to lose them. And you, as a Hanlock stalwart of the game, don't like it. I'm in the camp of it's probably not right.
Right.
He has, however, said he wants to come here and enjoy this tournament. If he enjoys Hanlock and he's comfortable with it and it works for him in playtesting, why not?
Agreed. And I think, you know, you can call that Moonfire a top deck if you want, but it honestly, he'd done his job that game. That is the big flaw with that Hanlock deck now, is that once he'd got Oya down to that 15 number, that deck's not going to go above 15.
Exactly.
There was only the one Farseer and the one Refreshment Vendor left in the deck, and he'd have to be life tapping to get to them consistently, so he'd be lowering his own health anyway. So any time that Moonfire was drawn, it was going to end the game. It didn't have to be that turn, and it didn't matter how many taunts that Oya was able to put up in the way, because Malagos don't give a damn about your taunts.
Yeah, and so, I think Gundam played well, apart from that little wobbly patch in the middle where he had that awful turn against the Warrior where he just attacked the wrong things and got himself in a muddle.
Yeah.
Apart from that one time, he regathered himself pretty well. I think he was a deserving winner. We know it's the meme, but we've been calling this guy all the way through, so one more match for him. And if he wins that match, or whoever wins that match, will be the APAC final. And don't want to sell his opponent Yatori short, though. He will also obviously be trying his hardest to get through there. But so glad that he got through this, I think, from there.
Yeah, I think he's been the standout player, has Gundam Flame. We've talked about it extensively.
Okay.
But
I think we should cut the stream, let people listen to the interviews if they are in Japanese, and we'll come back for the next game, I think.
Sure.
See you guys soon. It may be a slightly longer break, but there'll be at least something here to entertain you in the meantime.
すごいテンポ明示でロングゲームになるとは思ってなくて、もっと早い展開で終わらせようと思ってたんですけど、でもヨグが助けてくれました。
いや本当ですね、かなりもう他にもラグナロスやだいぶランダム要素多めなデッキ使われてましたけども、結構ギャンブラー気質なとこあるんですか？
そうですね、まあテンポ明示みたいに運要素が絡むのは、まあ自分もやってて楽しいですし、お客さんもみんな楽しんでると思うので、まあいいと思います。
いや、かなりパフォーマーな方でしたね、表情に似合わず。で、昨日、まあ、お話しさせていただいたときに、だいぶクールな感じで、ポーカーフェイスな感じでしたけども、今日だいぶ、まあ、画面見てる限り、表情豊かでしたけども、はい、まあ、昨日2回続けて配信してたじゃないですか、今日やっぱりその分来て落ち着いた感じだったんですかね。
まあ、そうですね、昨日自分だけ2回配信されて、ちょっと特別なのかなと思って。それで結構慣れました。
いいですね。その後も決勝もかなりこれは落ち着いてプレーできるんじゃないですか。
まあそう思いたいですね。
いやそこも楽しみにしております。まあ、気になった点としましては、まあ、途中5ゲーム目なんですけども、ハンターのミラーマッチ、こうお互い荒野の呼び声引けずにかなりちょっと苦労してたところとかあると思うんですけど、いかがでした？
そうです。あのマッチアップは全体的に押されてて、こっちが完全に除去の方に回されてて、最後その挑発をつけてすごい惜しかったんですけど、まああれは全体的にしょうがないと思います。
まあそうですね、やはりここもトップで引いてくるっていうところ、どうしてもランダム要素を絡んできてしまうところであると思うんですけども、まあそこはうまく決勝戦もランダム要素、まあ、若干ですけども僕は期待してしまっているところありますね。楽しみにしております。さらにですね、やっぱりこう今最初におっしゃってましたけども、今回フルセットまで上がって、で最初序盤スムーズに勝ち上がってたじゃないですか。しかしそこからの結構フルセットまでだいぶきつかったんじゃないですかね。
そうです。最初2本取れた後に マリゴスドルイードでだいぶミスってしまって、もうあの時はだいぶ苦しかったんですけど、なんとか巻き返せてよかったです。
いや本当お疲れ様ですよね。もう他にも、まあ、今回まあ宇谷さん側なんですけど、ハンドロックなかなかこう見る機会ないじゃないですか。こう対戦してて一体こうどういった感じ意識して戦っていきました？
そうですね、やっぱりすごい不気味だったんですけど、まあ、全環境のハンドロックとかを思い出しつつ、なんかこういう感じだったかなっていうのと、まあ、昨日見返して、まあ、研究しました。
ただ宇谷さん、昨日のまあ配信等ではあまりカードをそこまでたくさん切ってないわけなので、その全貌があまり見えてなかったんじゃないかなっていうところもあるんですけども、そちらいかがでした？
まあ入ってるカードはだいたい読めてたので、そこからまあ逆算してこういう切り方をすればいいのかなとか考えました。
ありがとうございます。ズバリ今回の勝因一体何だったと思いますか？
まあ、1戦目が全てだったと思います。あれがなんか流れを決めてくれたと思います。
やっぱりヨグサロンと、まあ、さらにそちらのまあ、ランダム要素をしっかり取り入れていったと。
そうですね。
結構そのお願いみたいな感じ祈ってたところとかあるじゃないですか。どういった心境でした？
あれはまあ向こうはもう大きいミニオンっていうのが残ってなかったので、除去をしてくれさえすれば勝てると思ったので、それを願ってました。
まあ、結果しっかりとそこを除去できたと、お見事でございます。さあこの後決勝戦でございます。心境の方だけ聞かせていただいてもよろしいですか？
もうここまで来たら勝つしかないので、もう勝つか負けるかはもう天国と地獄なんで、勝ちたいと思います。
注目しております。さあありがとうございます。ガンダムフレーム選手でした。ありがとうございます。
ありがとうございます。